For me personally, I think the toughest part of my job is, I suppose it's having to do things that people don't like for the good of the whole.
And then you see your players and they're feeling down, maybe they're crying.
The one thing I didn't expect about coaching is how stressful it is. I feel probably more stressed as a coach than as a player.
My name is Dennis Nielsen. I'm the head coach of MOUZ. I'm from Denmark. I'm 26 years old. I take care of all the day-to-day things. I'm always with the team in practice. I'm always with the team at events. I'm the guy who's standing behind them when we're playing. I'm the guy who's taking the timeouts. I'm also the guy who's at the end calling the shots if we have to go a different direction.
I think one of the most important skills a coach needs is the ability to understand their players' emotions and how to get to them and like truly understand them, because every player works differently and you need to kind of understand how everyone works. And I think a really good coach will understand how to enable their players. So my name is Mathis Jabs Friesel. I am 25 years old and I am the assistant coach and analyst for Team Liquid's Dota team.
If our practice isn't good enough, if our results aren't good enough, if our scouting isn't good enough, if any part of our team isn't operating as well as it could be, then that responsibility is ultimately on me. I'm Mac, I'm 28 years old, I'm from Cambridge in the UK, and I'm the head coach of my Lions. I consider that the head coach's most important role is to establish the culture of the team. What kind of team do we want to be? What kind of values do we want to emphasize? What kind of practice culture do we want to set? All of those things.
I think my style of coaching, or just the person I am, has always developed. I think what I like to say is that you should constantly look to widening your horizons. And by this, I mean that you should always try to develop. If you have a beginner's mindset to everything, there is no limit.
Every time anything happens, it's a challenge and you just kind of grow from it. And that's also a big part of this job, just growing as a person and becoming more mature than what I was when I was a player, for example.
The whole reason that a strong culture in a team is important is because you need to have something that makes the people inside the team feel like they are separate from the others. You need to have a sense of otherness. You need to have a sense of belonging inside this unit, and that the people inside this are somehow different from all the people out there who say all of this random stuff about us, right? There's something that we understand that they don't. And part of that, for me, is taking care of each other. We always make sure, especially publicly, that we stand by each other. And I think that's a big, big part of something that I'm proud of that we've made at Mad Lions, right, is a culture where we take care of each other.
I guess like a lot of people think that coaches have to be super strict, like super like serious people, and like the only thing they do is help with strategy. But I think a lot of people don't realize that a lot of coaches can also be really clowny and just kind of be there to boost the mood.
I think all sports, and esports is no exception, are kind of a mix of arts and science, right? You have all of the soft skills on one side with the human element, and then on the other side you have all of the hard science, right? You have the statistics, you have the scouting, you have all of the measurements that we do, you have all of the ways that we look at other teams and try to break them down from a data perspective. So that's kind of our job as the coaches, is to get the science part and the human part to come together. And make sure that the players are able to be given all of that information in a way that makes sense to them, in a way that they can utilize, in a way that they can remember easily, right? And in a way that actually helps the team.
toughest part about the job is not succeeding when you felt like you've given it everything. When you go for a tournament and you feel like you've been prepared, you've done everything outside the game, inside the game, and then you see your players and they're feeling down. Maybe they're crying, they're frustrated, they're annoyed with themselves, they're not happy.
For me personally, I think the toughest part of my job is, I suppose it's having to do things that people don't like for the good of the whole, right? Having to tell people, sorry, you don't get to do that. You don't get to play that champion, or you don't get to like play the game that you want to play, or you don't get to carry on playing on this team. That's the worst one, by far. By far, I think no one is bigger than the team, right? And when it comes down to making those really hard decisions that put the team over everyone else and over everyone's individual feelings and my own individual feelings, those are the hard ones.
The one thing I didn't expect about coaching is how stressful it is. I feel probably more stressed as a coach than as a player. And I think it partly just has to do with the fact that as soon as the game starts, you're just out of it. You just sit there and you watch and just hope for the best. You're completely out of control.
You know, it's not like in conventional sports where you have timeouts and half times and things like that, right? Like, once the game starts, I'm not in the game, right? So my job as a coach is to make sure that they're prepared and happy and healthy, and then to make sure that once they're in the game, that they have the confidence and the agency and they feel the responsibility to lead themselves, to respond themselves, to have the right mindset for themselves, right? Those things are all not something that I can call a timeout and then influence and tell them to, like, you know, how that I want them to respond to this particular situation, right? So a lot of it comes down to preparation for what kind of mindset do I want you to have and what kind of team do we want to be in X and Y and Z situations.
I mean, in general, it's very tough in the business because everyone's always watching all your games. And if you're losing, it's your fault. If you're winning, it's not even your game. There's a tournament every few months, maybe multiple, thousands of people watching, huge expectations. And even death threats to some of the players on their personal Instagrams, Twitters, whatever it is. And it's something you have to deal with.
The more you play, the better you get. But at the same time, the more you play, the more you're going to travel, the more you're going to be exhausted. So you need to find somewhat of a balance.
It sounds nice coming into the office at like 12 every day and then playing scrims and going home, but the reality is that they go home and play solo queue until 2 or 3 a.m. every day and then wake up and repeat. And it's every single day with no break for 9 months. That's the way it works, right? And that's what their competitors are doing, and that's why we have to put in so many fail safes and checks and balances to make sure that they are okay emotionally, that they're okay mentally, because it's really, really hard.
Burnout is a huge aspect in the game, and I think in whatever you do, if you spend too much time doing it and it becomes a nuisance or more of a disciplinary routine you have to go through, then it starts getting to you.
When you stop having fun, when you stop being engaged with it, when you start wanting to play other games, when you start wanting to leave and go and hang out with friends or go to clubs at night, like, we can't do those things realistically, right? Those are not things that esports athletes get to do if they want to perform at their best level. And so it becomes really problematic when you no longer want to live and breathe League of Legends every single day.
I mean, what do I do to cope with the stress? There's not much, honestly. I think you just accept the fact that you're stressed. So during tournaments, you just kind of feel bad. That's just how it is. Other than that, I like to go to the gym. That's like my only de-stressor.
For this, I think my role is to make sure that I see all the guys in a good mindset. So I try to make sure that the environment is good, that it's a good culture, we have a good group, that everyone's enjoying their time as much as possible. Some of the things we do is we always try to take care of the players mentally by having weekly talks with our sports psychologist, team talks.
Since I've been in the LEC, we've come a long way. Pretty much in 2018 when I joined, it was like seven guys in a house, like pretty much seven teenagers in a house, like playing games and hoping for the best, right? Like you eat whatever you feel like and you sleep whenever you feel like.
It's crazy how much changed. Now we have this incredible facility where everyone has their own apartment, where everyone has their own space. And really, you only have to worry about the game. There's nothing else to worry about. Dota is a game that is played a lot on feeling and knowledge, but I think statistics and analytical science really comes in place when it comes to those 1-2% that really make the difference. So we always like to say that the difference between winning and losing is just 1%, and if you can get that 1% in your favor, then you're going to be the winner.
I think data is very important in Counter-Strike. The most important data for the team is that I just mention in my words how I think this enemy team is going to play. What is their general play style? It's a lot, how do this team like to approach the game? What generally do we have to be aware of? And what favorite strategies do they have on the different maps? This is like the main science or data we use.
At this point, we're choosing from the top 0.01% of players in the world for, you know, the five spots on our team. And that means that you have an incredible number of people to sift through. And data is a big part of that, of identifying, okay, these are the top 10 candidates that we should consider for this role based on this and this and this statistic in terms of identifying them as talents, right? So that helps us to develop a short list of players that we can then go and interview and psychologically like evaluate and ask for references for and do all of the like kind of legwork, right, of watching 20 of their games, right, which you don't have time to do if you have a larger list. So data helps us refine that list a lot.
We always try to play our style, no matter who you play, who we play against. Something that's maybe a little bit underrated. I think that's using data in general. I think the industry could really use that. Every team has one or two guys who are just really nerdy and geeky on it and just dives into spreadsheets, statistics, and tries to gain one or two percentages.
Yeah, so during last TI, I used the SAP tool every day, essentially, for the entire tournament. It was a big lifesaver, especially with the amount of matches we had played. I think we played over 60 matches throughout 1 month. And for every match, you have to spend hours to prepare.
I think one of the really nice things about data is that it's specific, right? Whenever you set a goal for someone as a coach, you ideally want it to be specific and measurable and time sensitive. Like, there's lots of criteria that you try to adhere to. Those things are often complex in a team setting, right? A lot of them are soft skills, a lot of them are communication, but data can help us to set really firm goals for people and give people an idea of how well they are progressing, right? So we track all of our scrim data internally, most teams do. So we can use data to inform the player's journey through improving with us in a way that is much more specific and quantifiable.
It really comes down to knowing every player on a personal level and understanding how they function. And that's kind of like a big part of my job, making sure that whichever data we have actually gets brought to them in a way that interests them, in a way that helps them, and not just a wall of numbers.
A lot of it comes down to presenting data in a way that makes sense for people and that is useful to people, that's easily digestible for people. And I think that gives us an advantage in the sense that different people learn differently, different people take on board ideas differently, right? Whereas some person might benefit from an explanation, another person might benefit from a diagram, another one might benefit from a chart, right? It really depends. And so I think that is, again, part of the way that we help to use data to kind of bring the science and the art together, right? To kind of bring the hard facts together with the soft skills and the people information in order to make sure that we have the best competitive edge.
So the next step that we're taking with the software would be analyzing our own practice matches in order to actually get even more information out of our practice itself. It's a lot of work and it takes a lot of time, but once it's done, it's going to be super useful that we can get all the info that we would usually get at tournaments also in our practice matches.
Now I'm traveling 150 plus days a year, and maybe more if we go deep into tournaments. Before it was a lot online. We only went to a few boot camps and a few LAN tournaments. That was it.
You know, I want to be in a stadium full of like 10,000 people and kind of experience that and feel the energy and like hear the way that the crowd's voices vibrate through your whole body. It's incredible.
And if we happen to get a trophy early on, I think it becomes much easier to win later on. Once you get the first one, you understand what it takes to win and you have way more belief in it. Not that we're lacking belief right now, but you just understand that, hey, it's not that difficult, you know? I've already done it once before. I know how to deal with the pressure, the expectations, and just the momentum you can get from it is quite important.
I never promise results, and I don't like talking about expectations. That's not the type of coach I am. I'm much more interested in having a good process than I am interested in having good results, right? I think that if you do all the steps right, then you will win eventually as a byproduct, right? Like, excellence is a behavior. It's a habit. It's something that you do every day in practice, and that's where championships are won for me.